Good evening, everyone. Welcome tonight to our town hall. First of all, it is never this easy with students. You walk in a room like this and you try to start talking. Faculty's about the same way, where the chatter will just continue. So we appreciate you coming to order and coming quickly to tonight. But also, just thanks for coming out. I know you have a lot of options on a Monday night, and it's good to see the community here this evening to hear where we are and what we're doing. Tonight we have special programming with Kevin Chang, who's our director of Chinese. He'll be talking a little bit about our future DLI, or dual language program, that we're going to begin in 2025. We also have Dr. Kim. Harold Kim is our board chair, and he'll be speaking a little bit about strategically how the school operates, more information, giving you a state of the school address, if you will. But before we get to Dr. Kim, we also have an update on our school website that Carrie Chen will be providing. So three good topics for us tonight to look at and to kind of see where we are as a school. And also, we'll have a chance for questions and answers at the end, where that's a chance for you in the audience to ask questions. There's a few that have come in online as well, and we're excited about answering those. And that's what these three chairs are, as Kevin, myself, and Harold will be put on the hot seat just for you. So we're excited about that this evening. Tonight we're going to start with Kevin Chang, Director of Chinese Language, and Director of World Language. He works with Chinese, French, Spanish as well. Before Kevin comes up, I just want to say a few things. Kevin's been with us about two and a half years, and he comes from California, where he was at the American International School, or Chinese American International School, and he ran a dual language program there as well. And when we look at what our goals are for students in our school, it's to provide opportunities not only that will be sustainable today, but for the future. And for years, we've been talking about how to better our school with our Chinese community, as well as our English-speaking community, to enhance Chinese studies. And we've researched for many, many months looking at how we might begin a dual language program. Now, the hardest thing that you're going to hear tonight is that this dual language program is great, except if you have children who are currently in the school. So I'm going to go ahead and save Kevin that question right now, because unless you want to have more children, which you can do, we in education love that because it keeps us employed, but that idea that this is for R1 students starting in 2025. Now, if you've already banked ahead and got a student coming into us in 2025, we'll be glad to accept that application and see how it works. But that program that Kevin's going to introduce is very, very much in the planning process as we talk about. And a lot of the questions you may have, he'll try to address the bigger topics today, but the smaller, more incremental ones will be more difficult because we have a year to put it together. And that's our goal for it. So again, we're going to turn it over to Kevin Chang, Director of World Language.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Ron, for that great introduction. I think he probably already covered everything I need to say tonight. So thank you very much for coming tonight. And well, before the Chinese New Year, I sent out an email communication sharing a very exciting news about our dual language immersion program. So I'm sure the email communication is not going to explain everything. So today, I'm going to take this opportunity to go into a little bit more detail about how we think about this program, how we're going to make this program work. So first question is, why are we doing the DLI program? So basically, it's an effort for us to continue to grow, improve, and expand our program. And we know our Chinese studies program right now is very well established. And it's a time for us to really think about how we can better take care of our diverse community. And there's a demand for and belief for dual language program. So in all, the purpose of having this program is to serve the diverse community and family and population, and also to diversify our program. It's giving another option and choice to our family. It's not a shift, it's an expansion of our program. And I'm going to going to the program structure. So first I'm gonna go into the structure and our students. So basically the program structure will be, we're gonna start our first year in R1 for in 2025-2026, so it's 2 years from now. So in order to do this program well, we need to give us a little bit more time to prepare it. So we already hired a dual language immersion coordinator to help us plan for the whole thing. So she will, it's a she. So she will have a entire year to work with me, with Jeff, the lower primary principal, and Faye to design the curriculum for our youngest grade level R1 ready. And for our students, starting with 2025, we will go vertically up each year. Every year we have two classes going vertically up. So basically, the first year, only two classes in R1 will be the dual language immersion, and the rest of the eight will still be the mainstream program. So the two classes will move up each year, every grade level. And so when the students move up to each grade level, the students, just like any other classes, the students in this program, in this track, will be reshuffled, basically based on many different type of information factor to kind of remix the students. And so in terms of our teachers, it's very, very likely we're gonna hire a new Chinese teacher because the skill set for the dual language immersion teacher is different from a pure language teacher. That teacher will need to know how to teach social emotional, need to know the American Common Core Standard, how to unpack the Common Core Standard into teaching and learning, and need to collaborate with the homeroom teacher. Basically, we're hiring a Chinese homeroom teacher who will deliver the social emotional and the core content in the Chinese language. And of course, in addition to the core content, we will create a lot of opportunities for our students to work together, to mix together, and the core model for our dual language program. That's the reason why we don't call it bilingual, because it's very similar to what is happening in the US, is a one-way immersion. So basically students will stay in the Chinese language for the 50% of the time, as for R1 is probably all day. So the transition is minimized. So because the R1 day is a little shorter, it doesn't make sense to cut the day in half. So the teachers will co-plan, and the co-content will be delivered in the target language. And the 50% of instructional time will be in the target language. And so let's move on to the admission. So, oh yeah, so this is the visual that's been added to show you how the progression will work. So basically in 2025-26, there's only two classes out of the 10 R1 classes will be the dual language immersion. And in 26-27, it will be R1 and R2. Then R1, R2, and G1. So the entire track will go up to grade 5. As, well, although I'm not in charge of admission, and Vicky and I have a lot of numerous conversation about how the admission for this program will work. So basically, we're gonna follow the normal admission process. The application opened on May, this year, and for R1. And on the application form, they will have a opt-in box for you to check to for you to be, if you wish your child to be in this program, there's an opt-in box. So please think very carefully If you are, you check this box, you're committed to be in this program. And the entire admission process will remain normal. So basically, we'll follow the same timeline, the same requirement for HKIS R1 admission. And the next one is if we receive more demand for, because we have two classes of 32 spots, if we receive more application, a lottery system will be applied to select our students for placement. And the placement decision will be offered in February 2025. So the most important point is there is no additional requirement to be in this dual language immersion program. And so all the students need to do is to meet the basic HKIS requirement for admission. You know, like our purpose is to serve everybody. Thank you.
He's quick, he turned off the mic before he even got away. When I look at this program, our impetus is to create a fun HKIS way of learning Chinese, not to rote memorize our way in like everybody else does. And part of our process of delaying, slowly going through this step by step is to make sure we get it right. Kevin mentioned hiring of teachers is gonna be pivotal. We're not gonna be able to hire people just out of Asia that have worked in local schools or in areas like that, because we want them to understand the fundamentals of teaching in a school like HKIS. We want them to share the values that we have as a school at HKIS. And all that comes with a very hefty expectation around recruitment. So whoever is that teacher will be well-versed in what our strategies are around education. So I think all that kind of plays through. And I know, my youngest is in second grade. It's unfortunate. Ashley and I talked about it. We're not having any more children that we know of. But we want to make sure that that's an available thing as you know people in the community. And the impetus really for us is that we see this as a good opportunity for any child. We're not looking for kids whose parents both speak Mandarin and that's who we're filling it with. No, we want it to be a diverse group, international group, a group that represents the HKIS community that then can grow and develop through that program. So that's kind of where we are with the program. There'll be time for Q&A at the end, I think, but I jumped up here real quick. I'm not supposed to do that. I see Carrie looking at me, so I'm gonna back up and just give her the mic.
Thank you, Ron, and thank you, Kevin, for providing the detail on the DLI program. Like Ron said, we will have a Q&A afterwards. I'm sure you have lots of questions. Thank you for submitting the questions ahead of time. We had most of them about the DLI, and we condensed them into a few questions at the end, so more to come. So for those of you who are new here or don't know me, my name is Carrie Chen. I'm the Director of Marketing at HKIS. I'm part of the Advancement Office. You will have met most of my colleagues as you checked in today. Our responsibility, so the marketing team, Timothy, Debbie, and Stephanie and I, we're responsible for all communications in the school. So that includes your weekly newsletters, social media, and the website. So if you've been on the website for the last week, you will have seen that we got a facelift. So yes, we're really excited to launch the new hks.edu website. And we've spent this past year working on really sifting through our content and looking at who our audience is. So hks.edu.hk is aimed at our prospective parents and teachers. It is a marketing website. And we've taken all the detailed stuff about activities and where to pick up your kids and buses and Sodexo. We put that all into Dragonnet, and we haven't mixed the two. So you'll notice on the website that we've got, and I'm gonna click on it and just, I'm gonna go into the live site. Here, and we're gonna go here. And you'll notice that that was Jeff in the beginning, and now we have a new one, a new photo of an upper primary student. There's a beautiful ribbon that you'll see that flows throughout the whole website. And that ribbon is a unifying factor that represents the one thing that our school focuses on, and that is our mission. The mission unifies everything at our school. And so the ribbon ties that journey, that HKIS journey together from lower primary, upper primary, middle school, all the way to high school, and it doesn't end there. It ties the journey into the alumni journey. And so we're spending a lot more time talking about our alumni on this website, because that's who all your children are going to be when they graduate. And the amazing things that our alumni are doing here, those stories need to be told. So I encourage you to take time to just navigate through the website. There's a feedback form that was shared in the newsletter, as well as on HKIS Central. Please, when you find mistakes, missing information, you can't find something, send it in through the feedback form. We are getting feedback, and we're fixing things as fast as we can. There is no quick links yet, and I know a lot of you probably used quick links a lot, but we want you to navigate and take a look at how things are laid out. We might end up with quick links after a while, if 2 months later we still can't find stuff, but hopefully the navigation is easier. I just want to give a couple of tips before I hand it over to Harold. So this is the navigation, right? So that's the burger menu, and you can find everything here. But everyone in here, mostly, are current parents and employees. And so I want to highlight here that there are three places that you can go with your portals. Dragonnet is where it's for parents, students, teachers, everything. So, you know, I'm going to click in there. But I want to point out there's an employee portal as well. So if you're an employee, you're not going to find the HR policies in this part. You have to go to the employee section for that. So you go in here, and HKIS Central is front and center. You can go to your division, okay? And every division, so this is probably a good page to bookmark. Every division has quick links. You can find the handbook, the newsletter, and what's really cool is you can actually search for people by their roles, by their name. Oh, there's Stephen. So it's a really easy navigation. And then underneath these three things are everything that you might need. So from Schoology, Schools Buddy, PowerSchool, the schedule. There's a little definition of what all these are for new parents. I had a request to say, can you define what all these things are? So everything's right here, and then it tells you where to go next. So after that, if you want to find out how to get involved, there's Parent Life, and you'll find everything you need to know about the PFO, the Booster Club, Chinese Studies, if you want to feed into the program, and Christian Life. These are all our parent groups. So navigate, explore, feedback to us. But I did want to just give you those short tips. If you're looking for things, go to the quick links and you should be able to find everything you need. Okay. With that, I'm going to pass it off to Harold Kim, the chair of the HKIS Board of Managers.
My kids have already scoped this website out. I said it's very cool. Thank you, Harry.
Okay, how long do I have? 30 minutes. Oh, really? Come on. Good evening, everyone. There are a few things I wanted to cover. Let me start off, first of all, by thanking you for your support of the school. Monday night, I don't know, I thought 20 people might show up, so clearly I think it's Kevin Chang's DLI that brought everybody out. But thank you for coming out tonight, and indeed generally for your support of the school. The school is only as strong as our community. So when all of you are involved, we become much stronger. So thank you for that. Let me introduce myself very quickly. My name is Harold Kim. I'm the board chair. I've been associated with the school for almost 20 years. I have 6 kids, and all of them are HKIS products. 60 years of tuition, I think. So if anybody is approaching anything close to that number, let me know. I will buy you dinner. The school has been such an important part of our family, my family, both, of course, for my children, but also for myself. I've been a volunteer for almost that entire time, starting with soccer on Saturdays, community soccer, lower primary PAG for many years, middle school PAG for a year, education committee, and then finally the board. So this is my 12th school year on the board and my 9th year as chair. And it is really an honor to work with the colleagues that I have. In fact, quite a number of them are here today. Alistair Ho, Vincent Lee, Tim Blakely, Wade Yan, Leontine Chuang, and Joel. Pastor Joel, where are you? Ah, over there. So in fact, we have a quorum of the board here today. So if we need to authorize anything, we could do that. The role of the board. We have three roles, and those of you who have heard me speak hopefully will remember what our three roles are. The first is strategic thinking. So we're trying to think about what the school and the direction of the school should be for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. Some things are very obviously strategic, like building plans, and I'll talk a little bit about that with the slides. But other things are a little bit less tangible, like programming, or what are our plans for development of our staff and making sure that our faculty and staff are top notch. So these are all kind of board level issues. The second is we're the financial stewards for the resources of the school. So we have obviously the physical plant, which is amazing. We've been putting so much money back into our physical plant, but also the financial resources. So we are the trustees to make sure that that we continue, you know, for the next 50, 100 years. And finally, we our sole employment responsibility is the head of school. So we hire the head of school, we support the head of school, we evaluate the head of school. If necessary, we let the head of school go to hire a new one. I don't believe that is necessary. We have a terrific head of school. But Ron is our key employee. He is the person we work through. So we don't run the operational aspects of the school. When my kids were in school, my wife used to say, "Oh, lunch today was terrible." Blah, blah, blah. I say, "Go talk to Ron." Like, I don't have anything to do with that. That's an operational issue. Who we hire, how we hire, that's operational. Strategic is what programs do we want to put in place? What are our hiring needs? And then we pass it over to Ron to run the school. So there's a very, there's a division between our responsibilities. Sometimes it gets blurry, so we do work together very, very closely. But he is our sole employee. As a board, we have 5 focus areas that we consider. And again, as I go through the slides, 4 of the 5 are represented. So it's finance, self-explanatory, facilities, self-explanatory. I call it human resources, so kind of our professional staff, hiring and recruitment and evaluation, program development, so really the education program, the co-curricular program. And then the last is kind of this catch-all term we use called advancement. A lot of people associate advancement with fundraising. That is partially true. Advancement does involve fundraising. But it's much bigger than that. It's really advancing the mission of the school. So communications, you know, Carrie and her team have done an unbelievable job in the last several years bringing up our communication standards. I mean, during COVID, we had other schools asking us how we're doing it. We had other schools, parents at other schools looking to our website to find out what was going on when everything was changing. Working with our alumni, making our alumni engagement stronger. When your children graduate from this school, their association with the school should not end. It should be a lifetime engagement. I think about my own life. When I think about my high school, it is not something that I did many, many years ago. It is still ever present in my life, and we want that HKIS to play the same role for your children, the parent community. So advancement is really, you call it marketing, it's really building the mission of the school for everybody. So those are the 5 focus areas, and again, I'll go through some of them in a little bit more detail in a second. So tonight, this town hall is really, it's something we've done in the past. It's not something we've done every year. But we really thought, with all the disruption in the last 4 years, that we really needed to kind of reset. So, you know, it's kind of crazy to think about, but just a year ago, we were still wearing masks, right? And it wasn't that long ago. So we've had 4 years of incredible disruption. At the same time, we had pretty high turnover during those 4 years. Families were leaving, families are churning through. And so kind of when we're sitting here now and we think about our parent community, our student community, our faculty community, anywhere from a third of our parent and students to half of our faculty are new within the last 3 or 4 years. And in a normal year, we'll bring in a certain amount that are new, and we'll have town hall meetings, and we'll have back to school nights, and we'll all see each other, and, you know, we pass the stories of our school on then. But if we're all stuck at home on screens, we can't do that. And so what we wanted to do with this town hall is really have a community-wide kind of storytelling. Like, what have we been doing as a school for the last several years? And what is our trajectory? What does our momentum look like? And where do we think we're going for the next several years? The DLI program is an excellent example of all of these things, kind of our strategic thinking, response to demographics, response to demand, and what we're going to do over the next several years in that particular space. So I wanted to talk a little bit about that type of broader picture, multi-year strategy, I think is a good word for it. We don't have to do it every year, but we do need to keep reinforcing the message, because as new people come in, we need to kind of get them on board with the story that we tell, because our story is very, very good. And it only helps us, I think, to have all of our community know our story. So that's what today is. So I will go through not too many slides. It's really a review of kind of the last 10 years in some of these board focus areas. And then I'll talk a little bit about what we're thinking about over the next several years. And our goal, again, if you've heard me speak, I reiterate this as, you know, every time I get a chance to, our goal is to deliver the best American education of any international school globally. We have the resources to do it, we have the talent to do it, we have the desire to do it. We're in the most interesting space in the world right now, between kind of East and West. And we have the ability to build really unique children that will be kind of Western educated in terms of inquiry-based learning and conceptual thinking, but also really understand Asia and China. So I think we can do it. That is our mission, or that is our goal. Our mission is to do it in an American education context, again, in a Christian foundation and respecting spiritual lives of all. And then we have the SLRs and the mission, a vision statement to guide us. But that is our goal. Let's keep that in mind. Let's go to the first slide. So, coming into today, I met a parent who was asking me, how many applications do we have, and what's our enrollment is going up, other schools are going down. So I said, just wait, we're gonna cover these numbers. Can you see me in the back if I stand in front of this TV here? Okay, so this is the number of applications. This is 2013-14. This is last year, or this current school year. So we were about 1,300 and change applications 10 years ago. We are over 1,800 now, so above this line. So this is we're gonna have the most applications this year that we've ever received. Right, Vicky? Right. And this is in spite of all the stuff that's been going on. And it's not just local, it's international from China and also non-China international. So it's a very healthy mix. So applicant pool is very, very strong. You can see this dip, this is obviously COVID. But even through that the trend is still up. So on its own, it looks fine, looks pretty good. In fact, this beginning to end is roughly up about 30%. But given all the disruptions we've had during this time, particularly COVID, I think this is a very strong indication of demand for our program. Next one is enrollment. So we take these applications, and we obviously admit a certain number of kids. One thing I wanted to note on applications, interesting statistic. 10 years ago, two-thirds of the applications were for lower primary. So very heavily lower primary skewed. I joined the board at the end of 2012, and we had space in upper primary. So if you could walk in and get assessed, and if as long as you pass the assessment, we had space in upper primary. It was heavily lower primary skewed. Now it's about 40% lower primary. So now our demand is across the board. In fact, it's probably hardest now to get in like sixth grade, I think. We have 200 applications for 30 spots, something like that. So enrollment, 2585 kids. I think the previous year was like 2525, something like that. And then now we're 3,000. So this is deliberate. In fact, it wasn't necessary for us to grow, but what happened was during this process was when we put together the plans and got a government approval for this building, that building, and then eventually Site A and Site B and Titam. And one of the conditions for the government to grant us this land was that we would have 3,000 students by the end, because the government's challenge is enough international student spaces. And so it was our commitment to the government that we would be 3,000 by 2025. We in fact hit it last year. It was 2,999. So Why couldn't we just make it 3,000? Oh, we had 304, okay, and some people withdrew, all right. Anyway, so this is a something like high teens growth over this time period. So again, depending on, I was counting from 25, it's about 19%. So we increased enrollment about 60 to 19%, and applications are up about 30% over this time period. Now, again, this is great, strong growth, everything. You'll see we grew throughout COVID. And those of you who have friends at other international schools, you may know that some of our other peers had enrollment fall, in some cases by quite a bit, like 15%. So again, this, I think, is a data point in terms of demand for our programming. It's very, very strong. So even during COVID, we were able to grow. I felt kind of bad, because that one year when no expats were coming in, we basically cannibalized other schools in Hong Kong, very good schools in Hong Kong. But people were happy to come here, so we welcomed them. Some statistics, so back then, here, plus or minus, every year is a bit different, but the annual withdrawal rate expected was around 14 or 15%. So every year we'd have 14 or 15% of our kids leave. Now it's closer to 10. Again, I take out the COVID piece, because COVID's a little bit weird, but it's roughly 10%. This is a long-term trend. So if you go back a few years, it used to be 20% turnover, 25% turnover. So it's a long-term trend. So if you ask people who attended graduation 15, 20 years ago, at graduation, we asked graduating seniors to stand if you've been here since lower primary. Did you do this? It was just a handful of people who did. Now it's 30% of the class has been here since lower primary. So that trend is long-term. Expats staying longer and a diverse mix of expats. 10 years ago, we were, the children by passport were 57% US. We're at 44% now. So another long-term trend. And that is just every year the US number is ticking down 1%. 10 years ago, we were 57% self-identified Christian. Now that number is in the 40s. Another long-term trend. But you can see, so underlying enrollment is strong, again, which I read as a very good sign, and becoming more diverse. Okay, next one is tuition. So I know the number, the tuition communication went down, and I think we're looking at 3.5% next year. It pains the board to increase tuition. We don't like to do it. But we're in an inflationary environment. Costs continue to increase. Our medical premiums increase 10% a year, regardless. It's unbelievable how they can get away with it. Is anybody here from the healthcare industry? Can you give us better insurance rates? I mean, it's crazy. Also this coming year, we're adding what do you call them in the middle school? The house. We're adding another house in the middle school. So we started to prepare last year, but we didn't hire the teachers. So we kind of overstuffed the classes, and then this year we're going to hire a whole other house. So I think there's a game going on now about what the name of the new house should be. Have they decided yet? No? Repulse Bay House? No. Anyway, so our costs have gone up this year. The way we run the school financially is for operating academic operations to run break even. We do not look to make a profit in our operations. But I wanted to show this slide because we just had a tuition working group at the board level to look at our tuition and how we set it. And there, it's not a magic number. It's not a formula. It's actually blending a whole bunch of things. It's what programming do we want and what do we need to charge to cover it. It also, we consider how much other schools are charging, not just in Hong Kong, but in Asia, and what inflation is, a whole host of factors. Back here in 2009, 2010, I joined in 2012, 2013. We were routinely referred to as the most expensive school in Hong Kong. I hated seeing that. SEMP, every time would say, HKIS, comma, the most expensive school in Hong Kong, comma, something else. That's not a good strategy if we don't need to be. That's not the brand we were looking for. We want to be the cheapest, of the most expensive schools, if that makes sense. So in fact, this is actually what we've deliberately tried to do. So we've been very conscious about our tuition setting. Every year when Ron comes to the board with kind of the proposed budget for next year, there is a good amount of discussion that goes on. Like if we increase it 2%, what do we get? 3%, 4%? What if we increase it 1%, what do we get? What if we hold it flat, what do we lose? And over time, we are now, you know, this black line is us. So we went from the most expensive school in 09, and we are now fourth or fifth. I mean, all the grades are a little bit different, so it depends on what grade you choose. But we are now fourth or fifth, and in fact, the gap between us and this yellow unnamed peer school of ours, which is very well known and a very good school, is very large. So I think, to me, this is good fiscal discipline. And I want to show this because I want you to be, take some comfort that when we decide to raise tuition, it isn't some random decision. It is a very well discussed and considered decision that we make. So we left the school's names off on purpose. We didn't want to embarrass anybody. Next slide. So endowment. One of the things that we are very blessed with is to have a endowment. We use the endowment, partly the earnings generated by the endowment we can use for programming every year, so we're allowed to draw up to 3%. But it also gives us financial strength to do things. So for example, for Site A, when we needed to raise funding for Site A, we were able to rely on the fact that we had an endowment so we could borrow against it. I'll tell you the Site A story in a second. But our endowment, 2011, is about half of, is 500 million Hong Kong dollars. I think of everything in US dollars, so this is Hong Kong dollars. We're about a billion Hong Kong dollars right now as of end of January. So it's more than doubled in this time period, and this is just, it's outsourced to BlackRock. They do a good job, transparent, rules-driven. But it's very important for us that we have this because it gives us financial strength. Again, I'll tell you the story about how we used it for Site A in a second. But one of the things that happened during COVID, for example, was we had a petition going around. Did anybody sign that petition in this room? I hope not. Or if you did, I wish you'd talk to us before you did. There was a petition going around asking for the school to rebate 70% of the tuition paid because we were online. And of course, the argument there is, well, we paid all of our teachers, they all taught, so all of our costs are actually out the door. That was not a profitable year for HKIS. In fact, we deliberately lost money that year to recognize that some of our families were suffering financially. But the ask to return 70% of tuition, our tuition and our endowment, as it happens, tuition revenue is roughly equal to endowment, plus or minus. Actually, endowment's slightly bigger now. So to return 70% of tuition for a year would have meant to reduce this endowment by 70%. In fact, it was even worse because during COVID, we were, there was a point where we, you remember when the markets, March 2020, everything went way, way down. That was when the tuition was circulated. We were actually looking at a loss for that year. So loss of like 10 or 15% plus paying out another 70%, we would have decimated the endowment. So it was not the right thing to ask for, nor could we have done it. But I think it misunderstands the fundamental reason for why we have it. We have this for long-term financial security. It's very important for us. We're very lucky, actually, as a school, as a day school, to have it. I'm not aware of other Hong Kong peers that have something like this. So it's something we take care of. It's very important to us. Next slide. So buildings and facilities. Everybody knows we built this building. I hope everybody knows. We built this building only 6 years ago? 5 years ago? 7 years ago? Okay. So this used to be our old lower primary. It's completely redone. And then now it's this beautiful state-of-the-art facility. The following year, we did upper primary, where even though the shell of the building is the same, we completely revamped everything and added a lot of space, and now we're reinvesting even more money in Titam. So all of you who are primary school parents, your timing is perfect. Next year you go to middle school. Middle school is completely renovated. We'll have a brand new athletic center. We'll have a performing arts center. But let me show you actually the numbers. This is very interesting. So 2016-17, this is before we did this building, renovated this building, until end of the year when we will have finished Site A. Our square footage is going from, I think, what was it, 700,000 to 1.25 billion, a million square feet, something like that. Our square footage is going up 66%. This is just academic facilities, not the apartments, anything like that. So this jump from 2016 to 2017 was lower primary. So lower primary space, we increased by 140%. We more than doubled lower primary space. This jump is lower primary to upper primary, the redevelopment there. And even though the footprint is the same, we increased the space in the upper primary by 40%. We had additional playing floors. We took over Ken and we redeveloped that piece. So lower primary space increases 140%, upper primary space increases 40%. By the time, this is Site A. When we finish Site A, the square footage for Titan campus will increase by 50%. So on a per student basis, we've increased the square footage per student by almost 50%. So this student had 283 square foot of space on average. The current students will have 400. And even back here, we already have the biggest campus among the international schools. So we have added so much programming space. And what is it? It's art spaces, it's technology spaces, it's going to be all the gym, I mean, all the performing arts hall, it's going to be, it's unbelievable. We have really delivered value to our families. We have the best space in Hong Kong. So those are the numbers behind that. This is very integral to what the board does. This plan that we've been working off of was developed by the 04 board. So we're 20 years into this business plan, our facilities plan. Now we've changed it, we've moved things around, we've changed the order, but it's very recognizable when you look at the 04 plan and where we are now. It's been systematically, we built this, then we built this, and because this moves here, we built this. There are two more pieces to this. One will be, once we decant all the gym and the swimming pool to the new Site A building, then we'll redevelop that to a performing arts center. So right now our orchestra plays in a gym, graduations in a gym. I will be able to do this now in a 900 seat performing arts center. But what's really exciting is now with technology, we don't have to have a fixed floor auditorium. That floor can now move up and down and reconfigure to whatever we need. So we can do things like professional development on an ongoing basis, because we can just reconfigure that floor. It was like 20 minutes, a push of a button, 20 minutes, instead of a team of 20 guys spending hours to reconfigure something. So it gives us real flexibility to really expand what we're trying to do. And then out here, if I could draw the graph for 28, 29 will be the Site B dual language center, which should house about 200 students more. So kind of our foreseeable future over the next 5 years is we will add one more building. I don't know, what's the square footage of that building? I don't know off the top of my head. About $300 million and 200 more students. And I think that's where we'll be as a student number for a while. The story I wanted to tell you about our financial strength with regard to Site A was when we started to think about Site A in earnest, which was 12 years ago now. It took us 10 years to get the lease, 9 years to get the lease from the government. So lots of discussion with the government, partly included that commitment to get to 3,000 students. The government finally agrees, it's going to be great for us, good for Hong Kong. We go out to get a preliminary RFP, and the price tag comes in at 1.25 billion Hong Kong. Okay, so we think, all right, how do we finance that? So we'll have 400 million from debentures, and we'll have 400 million from a borrowing lending, Originally, we own a building, by the way, so we were thinking about selling that building to fund the rest of it. But a few things changed. One was the board decided that building was a strategic investment, so we were going to keep it. That's part of our endowment. It did not show up in our thing, so it's worth another $100 million U.S. And then, because of COVID, the price came down. So instead of $1.25 billion, when we actually went out to get the project, the actual tender was only, it was a billion. Meanwhile, we sold $400 million of debentures because there was a lot of demand in our community. And we were able to get bank funding for the balance. So we were able to move ahead with the project without having to sell this very valuable building and without having to dip further into our reserves. And it was, and the lending came because we had financial resources behind it. And that's our endowment. So it's very important for us. Carrie, next slide. Have I run over my time already? All right, faculty turnover, also very important to us. It's one measure of our human resources. I wanted to stretch this curve back further because if you went back a few years, you would have seen our faculty turnover was more like 16 to 18% consistently. We then put in a professional development program and a different scheme for compensation, which was very controversial at the time. Most schools pay by seniority. We're one of the few that do not. And in fact, when we started on this process, we were told this will fail. But we plowed through it. There was lots of turnover here. But you can see once we attracted faculty that liked the fact that they could grow faster and compensation was performance-based, our turnover is pretty much settled between 8 and 12%, except the COVID spike. 8 and 12 is our target. As an expat school, I don't think we can get below that because almost all of our teachers are expats themselves. So we're very happy with this outcome, and we've had schools ask us, how did you do it? And we brought the University of Wisconsin in to validate our methodology and help us improve how we execute this. But this is a very important part for us of attracting the faculty that we want and then retaining them. And once we build the Performing Arts Hall and we're able to host professional development conferences on a regular basis, we want to be known as a center for excellence for teaching in Asia. Already we do this 3 or 4 times a year where we bring in teachers from other schools in Asia and Hong Kong to come train here. We want to do it on a regular basis. We want to invite Hong Kong schools to join us. Because teachers are learners too. So if they think this is the best place to learn, they will want to come and teach. We're doing this for selfish reasons, because we can attract better faculty and we can keep them for longer. We're also doing it for community service reasons, because I think this will help the whole educational system. So I wanted to include a slide about this. This has been a very big focus for the board as well. Last two slides are about advancement and philanthropy and our community. So this first one is about annual giving. Annual giving and capital giving. I wanted to show how we're changing how we view this. This is financial philanthropy, so not donating your time or anything else like that. For many, many years, we had an annual fund that was basically centered around a big ball in May, and we would raise anywhere from $10 to $15 million. You could go back a few years; it still looks the same. It's all this color blue, and it's plus or minus the same. Which is fine, but if we really wanted to, if we really, really needed the money, we could probably just raise tuition to raise this and not even bother with any of this. Why do we do this? Because it brings the community together. Like when we have a big community party or when somebody has to give in excess of what they're being charged, that's a statement that they support the organization. So for many years we did this. We recognized that we wanted to change how we approached philanthropy, but we weren't able to do it because we didn't have the right advancement people. Now, we hired, those of you who have been here for a few years would remember Ann Wardwell. She came in from a U.S. boarding school background and understood how best in class in the U.S. System works. So she started to change our structure of philanthropy. But after 3 years, unfortunately, it was all COVID. But even with that, she was able to make some fundamental changes. And then Heath Hig and I joined us last year, is continuing with that. You can see now the way our philanthropy looks is quite different. Annual fund is still an important part of it, but now we have giving that's focused on our capital projects and our endowment, which has perpetual impact. And we've been able to kickstart projects that the board has wanted because we've had families donate at an endowment level. So a good example is we have a spiritual coordinator, spiritual life coordinator position before. We had a foundation actually donate the seed for that. So we hire somebody who is focused on spiritual life for our K-12 students. Similarly, we've kickstarted the experiential learning program with a seed donation from another family. So those fall into these top two buckets, which we never really had before. As we think about funding the Site B and the Performing Arts Auditorium, hopefully some of that will come from this bucket as well. So it's a very different kind of giving than just, hey, we're having a party, buy a table, let's get drunk, and which is fine, and we'll do that. May 3rd, by the way. But this is broader, and I think it's stronger for the school. The last slide. I see Ron looking at his watch. I'm almost done, Ron. This is just a sign, again, of a buy-in for the school's mission. Right? If you're a parent, you get an invoice. Of course you pay because you want your kid to go to the school. But to actually donate more than that means you're supporting the school. And so our administrators basically give 100%. That is great. The faculty, and then our families. I mean, anything above 50% is fantastic. You go to any kind of independent school and you ask them what their targets are. I mean, if you're above 50%, that means more than half of your families have bought into supporting your mission. So I wanted to end with that slide because that's really a thank you to you, right? This is showing that our families are also supporting us and are all in on what we're trying to do.